Museum and the Friends of the Hull Public Library. We're thankful for Hull Community Access Television for coming and taping our lectures every month, so thank you guys in the back for helping us out. As always, coffee and desserts are available over here up front, and the money from your donations help to pay for our speakers, so donations are graciously accepted. Without any further ado, I would like to introduce tonight's speaker. Tonight, we are really honored to welcome one of our very own, Victoria Stevens from the Hull Lifesaving Museum. Victoria earned her Bachelor of Art in Art History at Harvard University, followed by the Joint Master's in Art History and a Museum Studies Certificate Program at Tufts University. At the Hull Lifesaving Museum, Victoria works to develop exhibits and education programs that draw on Hull's rich lifesaving history and maritime heritage. Her recent projects include the museum's Simple Machines at Sea program for elementary school students and the Boston Harbor Shipwreck website. Please join me in welcoming our very own Victoria Stevens.
Thank you, Jessica. How's the sound? It's okay? We were working out some issues earlier. So thank you all for coming out tonight, especially ahead of the weather that we're expecting. And for those of you who, like me, are here every month for the lecture series, you know we've covered some wonderful topics. And when Jess and Ellen and I talked about the schedule for this year, we really wanted to take some time to focus on stories that are really close to home, because there are so many great stories here, and the Nancy is certainly one of them. And we know that there's so much knowledge and information within our own community about the Nancy and other aspects of our local history. So the plan for tonight is that I'm going to give a brief talk on the Nancy, an overview of the history, some that may be familiar to you, some that may be new. And then we're hoping that some of you may want to join in the discussion. So after I finish the slide presentation, Jessica will be coming around with the microphone. If anybody has comments or stories that they'd like to share, we really hope that you will do that. So we'll open it up after that for any stories that anybody might have. So here she is on the beach. This is the Nancy, certainly one of the most iconic views we have of Nantasket Beach. And I want to start out by talking a little bit about the storm that brought the Nancy ashore. And it's almost eerie. It was a Friday evening storm that lasted all day into Sunday, dumping about a foot of snow on the city of Boston. So very coincidental that that's pretty much the forecast we have for this weekend. Hopefully it will be less momentous than the Nancy storm. Now, in the story of the Nancy, there really was no loss of life or real danger here on Nantasket Beach. But the storm that brought the Nancy ashore was a tragic storm for several people. 12 people in the Boston area lost their lives during that February storm. Particularly tragic, 8 men lost their lives off Provincetown who were aboard the Coast Guard cutter, the CG-238, that lost engine power and then wrecked off Peak Hill Bars off Provincetown. So although we tend to think locally of the Nancy as a fun story, because compared to some of the other shipwrecks that happened here, it wasn't a particularly dangerous one, the storm was not an insignificant one. Now, we are lucky to have, like our friends with Hull Community Cable now who help us out with the lecture series, we have some oral histories that were done with folks who remembered the Nancy coming ashore. The oral histories were done about 30 years ago, so I have some of those interspersed. So right now, as I go to the next slide, we're going to have a short video with Dan Short, who is a longtime Hull resident and who remembered the Nancy coming ashore. So he's going to actually talk a little bit about the storm and the circumstances when the ship came in.
The night before was a real heavy, strong northeast, and the ship left Boston Harbor sometime in the afternoon, and when the captain saw that he was bucking a very strong storm, he decided to anchor off the entrance there to Boston Harbor out near the Harding's Ledge, and he was going to weather the storm out there, but the anchor chain broke, and he had to let the ship, you know, glide into land. And that finally landed here in Nantasket Beach. Mm-hmm. He picked a soft spot, I mean.
That's a great line. So there's a picture of the Nancy coming ashore that was in the paper.
What year?
1927.
Thank you.
Sure. Coming ashore, and another photograph taken apparently that same day. Now, although the Nancy's crew were not in serious danger, they did require rescue to get ashore. And they were fortunate that they had the best ready and waiting. Osceola James, who was the son of Joshua James, Hull's most famous lifesaver, saw the ship from his home, and he went down to the beach where crowds were already gathering to watch the ship come ashore. Osceola James had been a volunteer lifesaver really his entire life. He took over as the boat keeper for Hull's Massachusetts Humane Society volunteer crews in 1890 when his father Joshua James became the keeper of the U.S. Lifesaving Station. So for many years he'd been doing this, and he certainly had many crew members locally that he knew he could call upon. So he was interviewed about the rescue in the local paper, and this is what he said. I recognized in the crowd those men that I knew could row, like Jim Murphy, Captain Nickerson, Joe James, and Ed Hatch. Some of the others were strangers to me, but they did their part well. When I got to the beach and the Coast Guards were not there, we just went to work. I couldn't see any need of waiting. It was getting dark, and those men on the vessel wanted to come ashore. So he has a pretty matter-of-fact approach. I did notice that, you know, he mentions that the Coast Guard weren't there. He had called the Coast Guard station before he set out for the rescue. But the Coast Guard station was 5 miles from where the Nancy came ashore, and there was a Mass Humane Society boathouse right at Surfside where the Nancy had come in. So it was much quicker and easier for the Mass Humane Society crew to get there. But there also does seem to be a little bit of good-natured rivalry in some of the wreck reports that we've seen. So I think there was a little competition too. In order to get the surf boat from the Mass Humane Society boathouse, Osceola stopped a snowplow, which of course in those days was a horse-drawn snowplow, and asked them to take the horses from the snowplow and bring it down to the boathouse so that they could bring the surf boat to the beach. And we're fortunate that another of the oral histories we have is with John Kenneth Trapp, who was a 20-year-old DPW employee at the time who was driving the snowplow. So we have a short recollection of him in his role in the rescue. Okay, today is July 13th, 1986, and we're at the home of Mr. John Kenneth Trapp, who has lived in Hull for all his life.
For nearly 80 years. 80,
right.
80 in April.
80 years in April.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay, Mr. Trapp, could you tell us a little bit about, why don't we start out, you were born where? Right about in this area,
yeah,
in Hull?
Yeah.
In what year?
1907.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And you worked for the highway department,
yeah,
correct?
I went to work in the highway in 1924.
Mm-hmm.
And I retired in 62.
Okay.
When the Nancy came in, it was February 1927, a Sunday.
Uh-huh.
And I was on the snowplow with horses with Bill Bacon, and we went down through the MDC, and the captain came out and gave us a key for the Humane Society building was across from Manassas.
Oh.
And we went down, we hooked the, took the boat out and hooked it on the back of the snowplow with the horses and towed it down where the Nancy came in.
Wow.
And that time was, oh, 300 or 400 feet offshore, the boat was. And
what did you think when you saw it? It must have been.
Yeah. And the only ones, there's nobody living. I'm the only one left on that outfit. Louis Hurley was out on the boat, and Edwin Hatch, and Bob Blossom, and Captain James. He lived up on Center Hill, and he was a tiller man in the back of the boat. And they went, rowed out and brought the people in off the Nancy.
Did you row out?
No, they didn't.
They did. They rowed out on that boat.
On the Humane Society boat.
And that was from the station that was located where?
Right across from Manassas Hardware, down the beach.
There's this parking lot now.
Yeah, big red building. Yeah. Mm. Then there was another Humane Society building down the street here, corner of Stony Beach Road and Atlantic Avenue.
And that's the one Mr. Edwin Hatch worked out of.
Yeah.
Oh.
Now the only ones left is, I'm the only one left that was mixed up in towing the boat down and going out.
Right, right. So what time of day was this?
But it was after afternoon on a Sunday, after dinner.
Was there any lives in danger?
Oh, no, no.
No?
It wasn't rough or anything. Just out there riding. It hit the sand, I guess, and stopped, you know, the tide was low or something.
Mm-hmm.
And 2 weeks afterwards, I get a check from Mass Humane Society for $5. And Bill Bacon was driving the team, the horses, and he got a check for $5. The Nantasket Ice Company owned the horses, and they got $10.
So, now this boat was...
Five-master.
Five-master, and it had... And how long did it stay on Nantasket?
Oh, gee, for years. I worked down there in the WPA.
And then we have a picture of the surf boat underway going out to the Nancy, which is fairly rare that we have a picture going out to one of the rescues, because most of them were earlier in the late 1800s and earlier 1900s, so it's great to have that picture. This was kind of a last hurrah for the Hull Mass Humane Society crews, who had been active in town for more than 100 years at that point, but were gradually no longer needed as motor surf boats and the Coast Guard had evolved. So this was really the last time the Mass Humane Society volunteers in Hull went out on an active rescue. And we just have one more short interview talking about the crew. And this is Dan Short again. He's going to show some pictures and talk about the men who went out on the rescue. What I particularly like about this interview is that he talks a little bit about who everyone was in town. And I think that gives such a sense of the community that was here. We always try to get that across at the Lifesaving Museum, that all of the neighbors and people who lived around you would drop what they were doing and go out in a surf boat like this to rescue someone from a shipwreck, and it was just a regular part of life in Hull in those days, so I think he brings that across nicely.
This picture shows the rescuers and the crew coming ashore, and the captain of the vessel is right here, and this is a little dog, the mascot of the ship, and his head is just sticking out of the captain's suitcase. And this is one of the volunteers, Clifton Jager. He was a master painter. And there's Louis Hurley over there and some of the crew that are being walked up the beach after the landing. The captain was determined to take his dog with him, and he wouldn't leave the ship until they rescued the dog. The crew, the rescue crew, rowing out towards the vessel. But they're listed all here, Captain Osceola James, James H. Murphy, who is a Coast Guardsman, Clifton Jager, Robert Blossom, who became a police officer later on, Joseph James was a fisherman, lived here in the village, Edwin Hatch was a... The captain called him Captain Hatch. He was a lobster fisherman out of Green Hill. Frank Lean was also a lobster fisherman. And Louis Hurley, who owned Hurley's bathhouse up at the other end of the beach. Harry Olson was a mate on the Nantasket steamboats. And, of course, Captain Osceola James was the captain of the rescue crew.
And thanks to a private collector who's loaned it to us, we were able to also see the original wreck report for the Nancy, which is a great document that lists everyone who went out and the circumstances of the wreck, although in this case it was more of a grounding than a wreck. And we do have all of the crew members that they just described listed there. A few years ago at the Lifesaving Museum, we had a small exhibit on the Nancy, and we had a great surprise one day when this woman came in and was looking around and mentioned that she was Clifton Jager's daughter. She made a special trip to come out to Hull and see the exhibit, and she was really thrilled to see her father's name listed on the rec report and the photographs of him on the rescue, and to have her picture taken. This is a beautiful ship's portrait of the Nancy that is on loan to us that was recently painted. And here's a picture of the crew of the Nancy that were taken off the ship and brought back to the Point Allerton Lifesaving Station for shelter and food. And then it's best I can understand from the sources that I've seen, it seems that they did go back and actually stay on the schooner for a time before, I guess, it became apparent that she was going to stay and made other plans. But here they are. I believe this is at the Lifesaving Station. So, you know, reading these articles, I was really struck that when we have a news event today and everybody talks about Twitter and Facebook and things going viral and how fast word spreads, it's amazing to me how fast word of the Nancy spread back in 1927. From the very day it wrecked, there were newspaper reports of thousands of people flocking to the beach to see the ship. So it's really incredible how quickly word spread and how quickly people got down here. This is a Boston Globe article that, as you can see, describes the ship as being in Hull's front yard. And it was by no means an exaggeration, as you can see. I mean, it's barely touching these cottages. In fact, they said that it was such a sensation that the Hull police force had to, in an emergency, swear in extra police to control the crowd. So it was quite an event. I just love this picture because I feel like it really gives you a sense of scale. You know, I always think that the ship could have almost breached the whole width of the peninsula. You know, it's almost the same width. So it just is an amazing sight. These photographs that I'm showing now are in the Boston Public Library collection. And I did just a quick bit of research on the photographer, and it was an interesting note that he went to school out on the school at Thompson's Island, so before becoming a photographer. So it's an interesting link to our Boston Harbor Islands.
Where is that location on the peninsula, those photos?
The Nancy came ashore right between Whitehead Avenue and the Surfside Railroad Station, kind of across from Edgewater Road. From what I've read, it did shift depending on the storms, but that's where it's recorded as having come ashore. And is Mr. Lorman here who emailed me? You are? Okay. Mr. Lorman was one of the people who was kind enough to respond to the query that we put out for people who remembered the Nancy. His family lived on Whitehead Avenue, and I'm going to go back so we can maybe see the shot where it's here. Remembered that there were family stories of the bowsprit having to be sawn off because the ship was so far in that the bowsprit was interfering with the trains passing on the railroad bed at Surfside Station. Which, as I go through the pictures, keep that in mind because some of them you can really see how that's possible. And then Mr. Lorman also mentioned that kids in the family, who at the time were between 8 and 10 years old, remembered the local kids having a lot of fun. I'm going the wrong way. Swinging on the Tarzan swing of the ship, and it wasn't completely clear what that was, but as I looked at the pictures, I wondered if it was this chain that's hanging down here. You know, my son is 5, and he would definitely try to swing on that, so I could imagine that a lot of local kids probably did. This is one of my favorite pictures that I found. I wish it were better quality. But it's a little boy who's pointing up at the ship with a little girl and his dog. And if you can't read it from where you are, it says, Arthur Morris Billador showing Helen May Johnson the wonders of the sea while the pup looks on in wonderment. So I think it just captures both the story of the Nancy as an attraction and also just what childhood was like in that era.
Past the beach for how long?
And I'm just going to stop for a second and introduce Bess's Dan Short just one more talking about visiting the ship as a kid.
Pasca Beach for how long?
Oh, it was on the beach for 4 or 5 years.
And what did they use the boat for while it was on the beach?
Well, at first they tried to get it off. They spent time with towboats on high tides and tried to move it. But it was an impossible job, and they finally gave it up. And then they use the boat for sightseers, and they had a plank on the side which they lowered down so that people could board the vessel, and they charged admission for them to see it.
Did you ever board it? Did you ever go on board?
I went on board a couple times, yes.
Did you? What did they charge to get on?
It was 25 cents admission. Yeah. And there's pictures of it, you know, with the sign, admission 25 cents.
So, as Mr. Short mentioned, the first plan for what to do with this massive ship was to try to refloat it. And they did try many times. I love this newspaper article. It says, "All Hull in tears, it may lose the Nancy." And as the story goes to show, this was October of 1927, so within just a few months it had already become a local landmark. And there's a great quote in the newspaper article that says, "The Hull Chamber of Commerce is tearing its hair, and the concessionaires along Nantasket Beach are weeping and wringing their hands tonight. Captain Samuel C. Ford, owner and commander of the schooner, has let it be known that he is going to try to float the Nancy." So people were getting a pretty good income from all these thousands of people flocking to the beach. But as it turned out, they really had nothing to worry about. This was nothing was going to happen for a long time. They did try to float the Nancy that weekend. In fact, Captain Ford spent the morning of October 12th pumping out 1,000 tons of water that had been pumped into the hold of the Nancy to keep her at even keel, getting ready to try to float the ship. But they required wind to do that. They were, and they waited that day for the wind to pick up, and it never came. So the ship stayed right where it was. And as you'll see, it's a big disappointment to the 25,000 people that had come down to the beach to try to watch the Nancy float. As an interesting little aside, in one of the newspaper articles, it notes that the only real excitement that day came when an adventurer, a man named Vincent P. Taylor, came down to the beach, and he took up a collection for himself, and then he put on a rubber suit that floated him, that could allow him to lay on his back and float, and he paddled himself floating on his back around the Nancy as a kind of little publicity stunt, and I guess made a few bucks while they were waiting for the Nancy to float. But the newspapers at the time said that Captain Ford was not discouraged. He was certain he was going to get the Nancy off the beach that week, but it says the natives were skeptical. And I think they had good reason. This was still 1927. For at least another 6 years, the Nancy sat on the beach. They did find other uses for the ship, including as a billboard for the Nutro Drinks Company. And certainly that tourism trade continued. But the tourism trade was not without controversy. As you might expect, people weren't so sure about bringing thousands of visitors to pay admission for this ship. And there were numerous legal battles that came about as a result of the ship. And some of them were pretty interesting. In March 31st of 1927, a New Jersey dry dock company filed a petition for seizure of the schooner based on unpaid bills. They claimed that they had made repairs to the Nancy back in September of 1926 and had never been paid, and apparently sort of caught wind of the money that was being made as a tourism attraction, and they wanted their bills paid. I'm not sure how that one was ever resolved, but the admission certainly continued, so they must have managed. On April 21st, about a month later, another petition was filed. This one's pretty interesting. This was a Mr. James Crankshaw of Montreal who filed a claim that Captain Ford of the Nancy had been tried for piracy in Montreal and acquitted. And although he was acquitted, once he was acquitted, he never paid his legal fees. So they wanted to seize the schooner based on those legal fees. But he must have found his way out of it, because the Nancy was still there and he was still captain in July. And by that time, some of the Nancy's neighbors were reaching their limit of patience with thousands of people walking over their property to get to the ship. So a neighbor named Charles McDowell petitioned the courts for an injunction to stop people from crossing his property to get to the Nancy. And that injunction was successful. So they did. There was an injunction that said they could continue to bring visitors to the ship, but they could no longer cross his land. Questions also arose as to whether or not they could charge admission to the ship legally if it was on state property, on the state reservation, where we are now. So So there was some discussion of that, but it was determined that the schooner was north of the state property, so the state had no authorization around that. So despite all the legal battles and all the claims on the schooner, it stayed. You know, they weren't able to successfully remove it or stop the visitation. And it remained there, as I said, for many years. It really was more or less, as far as I can see, intact until 1932. And that was really the beginning of the end for the Nancy with a fire, as there was for so many of Hull's major landmarks. A fire struck in March of 1932, and the schooner was badly damaged. By that time, the schooner had come under the ownership of the Grossman Lumber Company out of Quincy. I've heard that they sold some of the masts to the Quincy Granite Quarries. I don't know if anybody here knows anything more about that. I'd be interested, but I have heard that. So Grossman's did make repairs to the schooner, but just a few months later in July, it was struck by another fire that further deteriorated the ship. So by 1933, the schooner had really become more of a nuisance than an attraction. And with the Depression in full swing at that point, and many people out of work, a good solution was found to obtain federal funds through a waterways appropriation that would put some Hull men to work dismantling the Nancy and also provide fuel from her timbers for people in town who needed it. So that did begin, and work got underway. But as best I can understand from the published articles, about a year later, work had stopped because the federal funds had run out. So the Nancy was never fully dismantled through the WPA project, but was left partially dismantled. And the next really published account that I could find of the Nancy was as late as 1940. There was a spring gale. This is a newspaper article from an April, I think it was April 22nd gale in 1940. And you can see tremendous damages to the cottages. And there was also just a brief note that mentioned that at Surfside, the hulk of the five-masted schooner Nancy was lifted from its sandy resting place and driven 800 feet south to the state reservation. So not too far from where we are tonight was the last published account of the Nancy that I could find. So I'm going to just go through a few more views of the Nancy that we have, just a last couple of views. This is one of my favorites. It kind of captures it in its last days, I think. And then we'd like to open it up to all of you. Maybe we can see by a show of hands, is there anybody out there who does have stories or family recollections of the Nancy?
Family story was that either a boom, probably, rather than a mast, was erected on, I think it's called Brewer's Hill, over in what's World's End now. It was a flagpole. It was there for years and years. That's just family stuff, informal.
On the hill at World's End? At World's End, did you say?
Yeah, at the right top of the hill where there's now a stone marker.
Oh, okay. That's interesting.
It was there for years and years. It was a gathering place for Hull Utes.
Yeah.
It would swim across from Sunset Point. Across the Ware River and up the hill.
Yeah, thank you. And thank you for sending me those stories. That was great to have
My
those.
Pleasure.
I appreciate it. Anybody else have questions or stories?
A question, Vicki. What was on the schooner?
Yeah.
What was there to it? What was there?
What was there?
What was the things? What was the cargo and what happened to the cargo after it?
The cargo? Good question. I'm sorry if I didn't mention that. It was a coal schooner, so it actually had just delivered its load of cargo in Boston before it was heading back to Philadelphia when the storm struck. So it wasn't carrying any coal at that point. Sure.
How large was the vessel, and would a crew of nine be considered small for a vessel seemingly quite large?
You know, that's a good question. I'm afraid I actually don't know the length of the vessel, but you can get a sense of the scale from the pictures. And a crew of nine really would not have been considered small for a vessel. Most of the rescues of schooners that we read about from the Joshua James era were anywhere from 5 to 10 crew. They didn't require a large crew to run the ship.
Do you know where and when the Nancy was built?
I'm sorry that I don't have all the information. I believe I've read that it was originally built for, I think it was the Canadian Navy, which surprised me. I just found that a little blurb in one of the articles, but at that point had, much later had been sold into as a coal schooner in Philadelphia. But it was initially built as a military vessel, but not an American one. I don't know. I'll throw that question out to the audience. Are the ribs still there? I've heard from many people that they are, but I've never seen it, so I can't say for sure.
Do you know how many wrecks there are on the hull?
You know, I don't have a final number. We have a great chart. I'm glad you mentioned it. We have a website called the Boston Harbor Shipwreck website, and it has a chart that shows many of the major wrecks. It's bostonshipwrecks.org. There are about 75 major wrecks on that, but it's certainly not all of them. So. At least that many, but well over, I would say. Yeah. Yeah.
Sorry, me again.
No, that's fine.
I have a false memory at the Hull Lifesaving Museum of there being a plaque or a bell or a wheel or something from the Nancy. Or did I dream?
We have a few things. We have a few little pieces of hardware fittings from the Nancy. We have the foghorn from the Nancy, which is a great story. Somebody had passed through Hull, just passed through in the 1970s and thought that it was a cool thing, saw it at a shop and purchased it. And then a few years back, he sent it to us from California. So we have that. And then we have a wonderful little half model that was just recently donated that was carved from wood from the Nancy. So we do have a few artifacts that relate to it, and certainly many photographs and things. But as far as I know, I don't think we have a wheel or a bell. But we do have a few things. Okay, we have just as one last thing while everybody's kind of... Oh, did you have one more?
You know what became of the captain was that his last...
You know, I don't know. It's really interesting to me because he's such a character from the articles as they emerge, but I wasn't able to find anything that said, you know, this is the day when he left or sold it. I would actually like to pursue that because there must be some record of when it was sold to the Grossman Company, some legal record of the sale. So I'm going to try to find out what I can about that, but so far I don't have an answer. Yeah. Well, I'm really happy to share this with you. One of our guests tonight... do you want to stand up? Her daughter is a songwriter and was inspired by this story of the Nancy to write a song and has it on her CD. So as we're kind of finishing up tonight, if you want to get a cup of coffee or refreshments, I'm going to put the song on and just let that play so you can hear it. It's a neat thing that the story of the Nancy continues to be present here and inspire us. Thank you so much for coming out tonight.
Sound of your voice, and I miss the rush of your skin, and I miss the still of the silence as you breathe out and I breathe in. If I could walk on water, if I could tell you what's next, I'd make you believe, I'd make you forget. Get high and loosen my lips, faith and desire in the swing of your hips. Just pull me down hard and drown me in love. So come on, get high and loosen my lips, faith and desire in the swing of your hips. Just pull me down hard and drown.